Here I'll show the basics of viewing VCF files in IGV. Before we look at a VCF in IGV, let's review what a VCF file is. VCF stands for Variant Call Format, and as opposed to a FASTA or BAM file, which store long genomic sequences, VCF files store variants only. To understand better, let's take a look at the VCF file we'll be loading into IGV. So here it is. This is the top of our VCF file. As we scroll down, we're going to see the three parts that make up a VCF: the meta information, the header, and the variants. What we see here are rows of meta information, which always start with a double hash. More importantly, we see the version of the VCF format and the reference genome that was used to call the variants in this file. Let's scroll down through the rest of the meta information until we come to the header. Believe it or not, this is one line of data. It's just so long that it needs to be wrapped onto multiple lines. Each item in the header is a column in the VCF. These first 8 columns are required in VCF files and define the variant site. They are the chromosome the variant is on, its position, its name, its reference allele, its mutant or alternate allele, its quality, whether it passed the filter applied, and finally, the additional information. The remaining columns are optional and contain the sample data information. If a VCF contains data for one or more samples, then the format column specifies the sample data types and order. If a VCF doesn't have data for any samples, it won't have a format column. In this case, our VCF has genotype data for about 850 samples, which is why there is a format column followed by one column for each sample to store its genotype data for every variant. To see this in action, let's take a look at the first row of variant data. So in VCFs, every variant gets one row. So this is the information for a single variant. This is telling us that this variant, called RS55483915, is on chromosome 22 at this position. Its reference allele is T, its alternate allele is A, its quality is 100, and it passed the filter applied. Now, all of this information here is in the info column, and it's made up of key value pairs separated by semicolons that summarize the data for this variant in some way. The first key, AC, stands for allele count, and it's the total number of alternate alleles across all the samples. The next key, AF, stands for allele frequency, which is how often the alternate allele occurs. The source of the allele frequency data can vary depending on how the VCF was annotated. If you want to know more about these key value pairs or the VCF format in general, check out this VCF specification. Next, there is a GT in the format column, which tells us that there is only genotype information in the sample columns that follow. And finally, we have the genotypes of each of our samples. Our first sample is 00, meaning that it's homozygous for the reference allele, so its genotype is TT. But this sample way down here is 01, meaning it has one copy of the alternate allele A, so its genotype is AT. This single alternate allele across all the samples explains why the allele count in the info column is 1. If we scroll down, we can see that the VCF file continues like this. So with all of that in mind, let's take a look at this VCF in IGV. Let's zoom into where our variant data is on chromosome 22. Great! First, notice the sample names on the left. Each of the 850 samples we saw in the VCF is here, even though we can only see some of them in this view. In the center is the genotype data for each sample. Above the genotype data is the variant information track. Remember those 8 required columns in a VCF? This track displays the data from those 8 columns for every variant. This means that if you load a VCF without sample data, this track stands alone. The variant information track is made up of colored bars which represent the allele fraction at each variant locus. Red represents the alternate allele, and blue represents the reference allele. If you click on an allele fraction bar, you can see a lot of useful information, like the reference allele, the alternate allele, and the alternate allele frequency. Notice that some of the allele fraction bars are on lower levels. These levels are actually meaningless and are only there to help with readability in places where variants are tightly packed. If we zoom in even more, we can see that not all locations have data. Do you remember how each variant got one row of data in the VCF file? Well, here, every location with data represents one row in the VCF file. And the places without data are simply genomic regions without variants in our VCF. If we go back to our VCF file, we can see our first variant is on chromosome 22 at this location. And if we zoom in to where our variants begin on chromosome 22, we can see a variant at that exact position. Which means if we scroll down, we should see that one sample with the heterozygous genotype. And there it is. Pretty cool, right? Now that we understand where the data is coming from, let's talk about color. As with sequencing data, gray means reference. But here, dark blue indicates a heterozygous variant, and light blue indicates a homozygous variant. If you don't like these colors, you can change them by going to View, Preferences, Variants, and choosing new colors. We see a lot of SNPs here, or single nucleotide polymorphisms, but insertions and deletions are also included in VCFs. This is an example of one. We can see from the pop-up that this is a deletion. Because indels span longer sequences, you can imagine a case like this, where an indel and a SNP overlap. So when a sample has a copy of the indel, but doesn't have the SNP, IGV grays out the location of the SNP to show this.